Hello everyone, my name is Chris, and today we're going to be talking about FPGA. In order to do so, we brought in Justin from Alchitry. We've been carrying the Alchitry V1 boards for the last couple of years, and we're very excited to bring in the V2 boards now. Justin, can you tell us more about these boards?
Yeah, the V2 system really represents a overhaul of not just the boards themselves, but also the software and new tutorials to go along with them.
So for the uninitiated, what is FPGA?
So FPGA stands for Field-Programmable Gate Array, but it's kind of a useless acronym if you don't already know what it means. What's most important is that they're programmable hardware. And that means you write something that looks like code, but is actually a hardware description language, not a programming language. And with that, you're describing a circuit, and the tools will take that description and figure out how to configure the FPGA to behave like that circuit. And you can do it as many times as you want. They're RAM-based, so you can program them over and over. And you can have, you know, then different circuits over and over. And since it all just exists in the FPGA, it's massively parallel. So you can get tons of performance on dedicated tasks, as well as FPGAs tend to have tons of I/O.
So we've been carrying, like I said, the V1 for a couple of years now. What's new with V2?
So the V2 boards are actually fairly similar to the V1s, but there's a couple notable differences that are nice improvements. The biggest change is the connectors. The connectors are now Hirose DF40s, which are much easier to find than the original ones, and they also have higher performance. Along with that redesign, we shrunk the boards by a whole centimeter, so now they're 45 by 55 millimeters. The power supplies also can take anywhere from 5 to 12 volts as opposed to only 5 volts of the V1. One of the important reasons that we changed the connectors was that these connectors are higher performance, meaning the signal integrity across them is better. This is the Alchitry CU V2, our entry-level board. It has 79 3.3 volt IOs, as well as 8 onboard LEDs and a button that you typically use as a reset. There's also a USB to serial interface that can run at up to 12 megabaud. The core of the CU is an FPGA from Lattice, and their proprietary tools require a license that is free for hobbyists and educators. One of the unique features about the CU is that the FPGA on it is fairly well supported by open source tools. This allows you to build projects on Macs, which you can't do with any of the proprietary tools. This is the Alchitry AU version 2, our most popular board. It features 104 I/O, 22 of which are triple voltage, meaning they can switch between 3.3, 2.5, or 1.8 volts, and 20 of those can be used as LVDS output pairs. And 2 of the I/O are at 1.3 volts. It also has 8 LEDs and 1 button on the board that is typically used as a reset again, and also has the same USB to serial interface that can run at 12 megabaud as the CU. There's also analog inputs, 1 dedicated and 8 that are mixed with the digital pins. Compared to the V1, there is a speed upgrade to the -2 grade. This allows for 20% faster DDR transfers as well as faster serial deserializer speeds. The proprietary tools for the AU are supported by a free license.
All right, so we have the entry-level Alchitry CU V2. We have the bestseller Alchitry AU V2, but I hear there's a third board on the horizon.
That's right. We have the Platinum, the PT, that's in development. This will be our flagship board, and the FPGA on it is actually the same family as the AU, which is the RTX 7, but it has about 3 times the capacity and more than double the I/O, which facilitates connectors on both sides of the board. And what's really interesting about that is the bottom actually has gigabit transceivers that run at up to 6.25 gigabits a second that facilitate protocols like PCIe 2.
Okay, so CU, AU, PT, how do I choose between the three?
Well, there's 2 big reasons why you would buy the CU. The first one is price. It's obviously the least expensive of our boards, and it's a great place to start if that's important to you. The other big reason is that it's supported by the open source tools. They're very easy to set up, meaning that you basically don't do anything. They're bundled with Alchitry Labs. It just works out of the box. And they can be used on a Mac, which is something you can't say about any of the proprietary tools. One of its big limiting factors, though, is that all the I/O is at 3.3 volts. If you're willing to take the step up to the AU, you really get a lot more features. First and foremost, the FPGA is about 3 times the capacity as the one on the CU. The AU supports many I/O standards that are not supported by the CU. In addition to your basic 3.3 volt level I/O, you can do things like TMDS, which is used by HDMI, LVDS, which is used by many high-speed things, and MIPI, which is used by a lot of LCDs and cameras. The proprietary tools for the AU are free to use and actively supported. They get you access to advanced features like the Vivado IP catalog and Vitis. The AU also includes 256 megabytes of DDR3 memory. Moving up from the AU, we have the PT, and it's really the AU's big brother. It's the choice you'd make if you need more I/O, more capacity, or the gigabit transceivers.
All right, so I've bought an Alchitry FPGA. How do I get it set up?
The first thing you should do is install Alchitry Labs version 2. This is a major overhaul from the version 1. It was a full rewrite from the ground up. One of the flagship features of version 2 is that it can now simulate Lucid code, including an interactive simulator that can be used to simulate the I/O board, which we'll get to in a little bit. This lets you walk through the first couple tutorials without even needing a board. Version 2 of Alchitry Labs supports not just the new boards, but the original version 1 boards as well. There are many example projects that you can use as templates to get started. There's also the built-in component library with many commonly used things like I2C, SPI, the memory interfaces, etc.
We've set up our FPGA. Now, what can we connect to it? Because I see a lot of options here.
Well, the obvious place to start is the BR, the breakout board. This board breaks out all the signals to easy to solder to 0.1 inch holes. And this can just snap right on top of the main board. And the standard version that I'm holding here is the same footprint as the main board. But the reason that we have a wide version is that the stack height between these boards is only 4 millimeters, and it can be difficult if you have wires hanging down below, or if you want to stack anything on top, you don't have access to the top of this anymore. So the wide version of the BR has optional headers that are available, and these allow for easy prototyping. Connecting these boards is really easy. Simply line them up and snap them together. To take them apart, simply lift it up from the side with the USB port. Next up is the I/O. It's really a great learning tool, and many of our early tutorials are based around it. It has 24 LEDs as well as 24 DIP switches, 5 buttons, and a 4-digit 7-segment LED display. Then there's the FT and the FT Plus. These feature a USB 3.1 port that allows you to transfer a lot of data from the board to your PC. The FT Plus is similar to the FT, but trades 18 more I/O pins for double the bandwidth. The FT can do 200 megabytes per second, and the FT Plus can go up to 400 megabytes per second. Then there's the SP and the FN. These are both for managing heat, and they both come with a heatsink. The SP makes space for a heatsink, while the FN not only makes space, but also actively pushes air across it. The heat generated by an FPGA is highly dependent on the design that you load onto it. The CU and AU will typically not need additional cooling, but the PT with its increased capacity very well could. Running here is our GPU demo that's also available in Alchitry Labs, actively rendering about 800 triangles at 24 frames per second, 720p. This is a great example of the computing power that an FPGA has. This particular example is using about 75% of the capacity of the AU.
Say I have an Alchitry V1 board. Can I use that with a V2 FPGA?
Yes, that's exactly what the V2 to V1 adapter is for. By connecting the adapter to your AU or CU, you effectively get the pinout of the original V1. This can then be used with any original V1 elements or any of your own designs. After specifying the V1 pinout, simply rebuild your project. Standoff screws are also available to protect the bottom of the board.
FPGAs are believed to be an intimidating subject, but with Alchitry, that barrier of entry becomes much more approachable.
There's never been a better time to learn digital design. Head over to alchitrylabs.com for tutorials and the rest of the documentation.
And all of these boards are now available on our website. All right, so I've bought an Alchitry FPGA. How do I get it set up? All right, say if I said all right, words, and we're very excited to, very. Thank you. That was way louder. An intimidating field. Damn it.
Oh, and the gigabit transceiver.
Do you want me to go into it right there? Okay. My bad.